Welcome to I Start First podcast. This is the most amazing episode today. We are talking to the fabulous Cynthia Sassy, founder of Fabulous Arizona and Fabulous Wisconsin. And we're going to talk all kinds of things fabulous, how to not get scrappy, how to not deal and worry about your haters. But most importantly, what does it really take to build a fabulous brand that expands over multiple states? And she will literally give you a blueprint of marketing, of getting started, and on exactly what it takes to build relationships instead of sales. Hi, loves. Welcome to I Start First podcast, the show for boss babes who start ideas, businesses, dreams, and lifestyle. I'm your host, Alenka Cullinan, founder of I Start First, speaker, author, and business coach, aka queen of pushing boss babes off the ledge. On this show, I chat with epic humans who are guaranteed to uplevel your business and mindset. Are you ready to sparkle up? Let's go. Hello, and welcome to this episode of I Start First podcast for women who are ready to start their dreams, businesses, careers, and lifestyle. I'm so, so excited to have you here today because you're going to meet one of my most favorite boss divas, a very fabulous woman who is going to tell you all about her. And welcome, Cynthia Sassy.
Hi, so excited to be here. Thanks for having me.
So excited to have you. So tell us more about your fabulous brand.
Yeah. So I'm the founder of FabulousArizona.com, which is a online lifestyle magazine. And I have recently started expanding to other states. So I have Fabulous Wisconsin already launched and I'm in the works of a few others. So I've got that, some digital marketing, personal branding, kind of a few different things going on. But digital publishing will probably be my main focus.
I love it. I love it, ladies. So even if you're out of state, we have the reach. And from what I can see, she's coming to your state very soon. So stay tuned for that. So I love your branding. And we've talked about this before, you know, Fabulous Arizona, of course, Fabulous Wisconsin, of course, it all sounds so, so fabulous. But what really, you know, what's the real story behind building the fabulous business?
Yeah, definitely. You know, and the thing about it is obviously with it being Fabulous Arizona and Fabulous Wisconsin and all that, everything's supposed to look really fabulous. So, you know, what people are seeing on social media is all the glitz and the glam and the, you know, fancy events and the, you know, beautiful hotels and meals that I get to check out and everything. But what a lot of people don't see is, you know, all the hard work that actually goes into doing it. And this is a really difficult industry to, you know, make it in the long term, I think. You know, I see a lot of people, it sounds really fun and looks really cool. So they start up a blog or an Instagram or something and they start doing this. And, you know, a year or two later, suddenly they're, you know, you're like, oh, what happened to them? Because it's just very, very exhausting to maintain that, keep up with the content, stay consistent. It's a lot of work. And so, you know, it's definitely not as fabulous, I guess, as it probably looks on the outside.
Yeah, because on the outside, everybody wants to be you. I mean, it's like you said, everybody wants the glam, you know, and the glitz and beautiful dresses and being on those stages.
Yeah. And not to say I take those things for granted because you know, I mean, it's amazing all the opportunities that I get, but it's definitely a lot of hard work.
Oh, 100%. And, you know, you brought up one word, consistency. And for everyone, you know, who is listening today, I love that. I stand behind that notion of consistency all the time. You are someone who embodies that. Can you share with them a little bit? You know, everybody nowadays looks on social media and they think, you know, they did 5 posts and here you go, 10,000 followers, here we come. Or they build a website and everybody comes. Can you expand a little bit on more on what consistency really means?
Right. I mean, so I started Fabulous Arizona. It's been over eight years, I think now. So it's been a long time. And so I have, you know, people come to me now that have, you know, they started 6 months ago, a year ago, maybe even a couple years ago. And, you know, they're expecting this to happen overnight and they think there's some magic, you know, potion that just, you know, I can tell them, oh, go do this. And suddenly you're going to be where I'm at. And it really takes a long time of building those relationships, building up the content, the audience. And this, I think, goes for any business, especially with the social media, any kind of blogging or content creation you're doing to, you know, build your business, with the marketing in general. So, you know, something that I've really tried to do is, you know, for the website is have an editorial calendar. So there's certain pieces of content that come out every week or seasonally that are always going to be staples that are always going to be there so that I consistently have new content coming out. And I set those deadlines for myself so that they have to, like I have a weekly newsletter that comes out. There's certain pieces of content that have to be up before that newsletter can go out every week. And, you know, and I, you know, staying consistent with that is really important. So even if I don't have an advertiser that week that, you know, was going to notice it didn't go out, I still need to, you know, send it out and make sure it gets out. You know, the readers are expecting that every week. So, you know, doing that consistency, as far as social media goes, this would apply to any business, putting together a schedule and, you know, knowing in advance what you're going to post and when you're going to post it and being consistent about that, I think is really, really important. You know, and it's one of those things where I feel like if you plan ahead for it, it makes it so much easier instead of trying to come up with things on the fly day of what you're going to post. If you can put together a schedule the week in advance, it's going to save you so much time and help you be more consistent because you went and spent an hour putting together a whole week's worth of content. And now, you know, day of, all you have to do is copy and paste what you had already put together.
Yeah, no, I love it. I hope, ladies, you're taking notes because she's literally drew, like, she's giving you golden nuggets here. I mean, this is like 101 and 202 all at once. People pay money for those trainings. It is so, so true. I mean, I love that. I love the editorial content. I love the fact that you have, and I mean, you know, you said something that is so incredibly important when you said, you know, even if I don't have an advertiser, even if it's, you know, not doing it for someone, you have to do it for you because this is your brand and you're planning.
Especially when you don't have a boss, it's like, he's going to yell at you if you don't do it. Like, and so it's like, you're just, you know, holding yourself accountable for those things and knowing, you know, and that's what's nice about having something that you do weekly or monthly that you know, like, I have to hit this deadline every month or every week. Without a boss, it's important to set those deadlines for yourself.
Yes. Sometimes, I mean, we can be our own worst boss. There is no doubt about that. And so, yeah, honestly, I think a lot of young entrepreneurs, this is where they fail. You know, we fail on consistency because you start on something and then, yes, you don't see the results. You don't see the numbers you want to hit. And before you know it, it's like you said, you look a few months later and they're not even there anymore because they just, and they just gave up or walk away. So ladies, just make sure you really listen to Cynthia and what she's saying with you are doing it for you. You're doing it for your brand, not for the boss, not for your, you know, you're doing it for your audience. Essentially, you're building it for your tribe and with your heart, hopefully in it. And, you know, I mean, obviously you've had hard moments in your career. Have you ever came to the point where you're just like, done, I just want to walk away? And what got you through that?
You know, I don't think that I ever thought that, but I definitely had friends and family that were like, what are you doing?
Oh, yes.
Like, you need to go get a real job and give up. And so I, you know, definitely, especially starting out, going from, you know, I side hustled this for 4 years before I went self-employed. And so going from having a steady paycheck to literally no money coming in at all, it was incredibly difficult financially. And it just really got to a point that, you know, my friends and family were like, are you going to be homeless? Like, do you should go get a job? And for me, I had this vision in my head of what I knew it could be. And so that's what kept driving me. And so I think when you're having those moments where you're doubting yourself, you really have to like look for, remind yourself one of the moments, like the wins, all the wins that you had, those moments where it was like, okay, this is working. So kind of keeping those in the back of your head to remind yourself of like when, you know, of the good things that are, you know, because those bad things can sometimes kind of just take over and really set a lot of doubt in your mind. And so I think focusing on the little wins and also keeping that big picture and long-term vision in mind all the time of like what you're working towards. Obviously there are some instances where something's just not working and you got to know when to like cut it loose. And that definitely I think occurs. And that's something you also have to be, you know, I guess, humble enough to admit. But for me, I always saw where this could go and what this could be if I could stick with it and be consistent. So just kind of keeping that bigger picture vision in mind, and you know, really hanging out of those little wins of seeing this is working and you know, and moving forward with that.
Yeah, no, so true. I mean, and honestly, the best part is what you said, where you emphasized be humble enough to change things. I mean, be humble enough to say, if it's not working, how do I restructure this? How do I look at this and walk away? Because a lot of times as entrepreneurs, you know, when we're building something and it's our baby, we're like, we can't give up on anything. This is, we built that one idea, right?
Absolutely.
And we're so attached to it. So yes, this is probably $1 million advice right here, ladies. Don't be humble enough to let it go. If it's not working, either pivot or figure out a better plan, a better structure. But I want to come back to something you brought up, because we have a lot of, you know, young entrepreneurs, young career women starting out, and a lot of times they do get criticized by the closest, right? And it's probably the hardest when you get criticized by friends and family, because they are the closest to you, they judge you the harshest. What's the best way to deal with it? I mean, there is no best way, but I mean.
Well, and I think, you know, parents are probably the hardest on us, because it's just a different generation. They're used to, like, you have a steady paycheck and health care and all these things, you know, and so in their generation, it was like, you know, they're worried about us, and they're worried, you know, about the instability of going out on your own. And it is scary, and it's not for everybody. But I think surrounding yourself with like-minded people is the biggest hack on, you know, keeping that out of mind and keeping, you know, moving ahead and not letting those voices get to you. Because if all you have are those people that are telling you it's not going to work, eventually it's going to break you down and you're going to start believing it too. So I think it's so important to have, you know, surround yourself with people like, you know, all the boss babes and your tribe, you know, coming to, you know, your events and finding those like-minded people that are in the same missions. So that way you guys can kind of lean on each other and talk to each other and lift each other up. So that way you can continue to move forward and have those positive voices and influences to help you stay in the right mindset to stick with it.
Yeah, no, I love it so, so much. Yes. I mean, parents, I remember my own mother who, when I quit my job teaching, FYI, for everybody, if you haven't heard that story, she hasn't talked to me. She literally hasn't spoken to me for about 7 months. And she kind of made that joke within my friends and family circle, saying how I used to sell stockings. Like, that was her version of me building my company, because it was so obscure and she couldn't quite understand what I wanted to build. Because again, like Cynthia just said, it's a very different generation, right? They were not used to having 3-4 side hustles and building their careers, and they're used to everything consistent. So she literally called it selling stockings. So yeah, it's kind of a still inside joke. But yes, I love what you said. It's finding those like-minded people who will, you know, get you through this hard things. But one of the things about building a digital business like yours, I mean, it's a positive and a negative, I think, is the fact that you're in public eye so much. And, yes, you know, a lot of the women who we have are listening on social media. I'm sure most of you are. And I know that a lot of times we deal with that sort of aftermath of social media, where I'm sure you've seen it in your business, where you get negative comments, possibly negative, you know, some kind of negative aftermath. How difficult is that for you to overcome that? And what would be a good advice for our sort of starting out entrepreneurs? You know, when we get negative comments, when we get that whiplash, what's the best way to overcome that?
So I think, I feel this is something that I actually dealt with like way before like the digital world. And I remember this thought always stuck with me, and it's helped me through this. It's something that I went through in high school. And when I was a freshman in high school, I was like, it was my dream to be like captain of the cheer squad and prom queen and all these things. And so I worked all 4 years towards like, you know, building up to, you know, achieving all these things by my senior year. And I, you know, was homecoming queen, prom queen. I got captain of the cheer squad, editor of the newspaper. Like, I got all these things I worked so hard for. And then I was like had so many people hating me. And so it was like, I remember being so upset and so devastated that I lost so many friends by trying to like achieve all these things. And then I realized, well, if I never put myself out there, then, you know, if nobody knows me, then nobody can hate on me. But it was like that, then I'm never going to do anything. So, you know, that's kind of the trade-off. You have to realize that, like, if you want to put yourself out there, you're going to have haters. And, you know, and if you think of any celebrity in the world, I mean, no matter how amazing they are, they are going to have haters. And so it's just a matter of sheer numbers. Like if you're doing anything at all in life, like people are going to dislike it or hate on it or whatever it is. And 9 times out of 10, if somebody's hating on something unnecessarily and, you know, just being mean, if anything, I feel bad for them, you know, because I feel like that's more of a reflection on them and how they feel about themselves than it is about you. So, so I typically, you know, don't internalize that much and kind of just actually feel more sorry for them than I do, than, you know, than I let it get to myself. So,
yes.
Again, all about like framing it in your mind of like how you think about something like that.
Yeah, no, agreed. I could heart this 10 times over if we were on social media right now, but it's so, so true because, yeah, I mean, I love that phrase, you know, if I don't put myself out there, I don't get to do anything. I mean, it is so, so true. And honestly, I think it's also where that power of a tribe comes in. And I just recently was explaining it to one of my clients. I said, you know, when you're starting out and you get 2 comments on your post and one is positive and one is negative, you basically, I have 50-50 mood, right? You get hit by either positive or negative. But once you build that tribe of women who are like-minded, once you have that huge group around you, you know, if among 30 comments, one posts something that's just, nah, you don't care anymore because you have 29 going, you got this girl, you go, babe, you're rocking it. So yeah, it's definitely a combination of your mindset. And that's what I love with, you know, that you brought it up. It's how you position that, how you perceive that, but also being consistent and building those relationships that are going to love on you and have you back no matter what. So yeah, it's so, so true.
Well, and it's like you putting that out there too. I mean, like, so if you are going through Instagram and, you know, being everyone else's cheerleader, they're going to do it back to you. So yeah. I think it's equally as important for you to be making the effort to cheer other women on. So that way they're going to do the same in return.
Yes. Oh, so, so, oh, I love this. Love this. Yes. You have to put out what you want to receive, right?
That's yes.
That famous law of attraction. It's exchange of energy. No, absolutely. Yes. So when you, so obviously, like you said, you get incredible opportunities with Fabulous Arizona and you have chances to experience all this pretty special things. What else besides that, obviously, which is, you know, that's kind of the part that we see. What else is within your brand that you absolutely love? Like, what are some other favorite things? Because for women who want to build a digital brand, like, what else do they have to look forward to? Give them a little teaser.
I think the biggest thing that I love the most that people probably don't even get to see that much is meeting the people I meet, whether it be other people in my industry or, you know, other business owners. That's actually kind of what fuels me and why I love doing the local magazine as opposed to doing something, you know, larger, because I used to work in national publications and, you know, working with a 21-year-old account executive at Target who really doesn't care about Target is just not very fulfilling, as opposed to like you meet, you know, a restaurant owner here who has poured every dime of their in their pocket into this business that they're so passionate about. And that's just like such a much more rewarding business to work with and promote. So for me, hearing people's stories and, you know, getting to meet so many amazing people that are so passionate about what they do is hands down my favorite aspect of what I do.
Oh, I just got goosebumps from that. I mean, ladies, and can I just want to expand on that a little bit because you and I actually had these conversations before. I mean, part of what you do obviously is sales, right? But you and I talked so much and you just brought up that magic word, relationships.
Yes.
So I want you to expand a little bit more what true, and like, I want to, you know, give you a testimony. Cynthia is probably one of the best relationship builders, ladies, that I've ever come across. I mean, this woman knows it. She studies people. She truly pours her heart in every person she works with, in anything she does. So give them a little bit more of your, you know, fabulous approach to building sales in through relationships, which you do best.
Yeah, I think a really big mistake that some people do when they first start out is they're And I understand it because you're scrappy and you're like trying to like make it and survive. But I think people ask for too much when they're first starting. And I love Gary Vaynerchuk's saying of give, 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 then ask. And it's like, once you've given so much to someone, they're going to be so much more receptive to, you know, giving back in return. And so, and I also believe strongly in proving your worth, you know, in order for someone to invest back in you. So, you know, I really try to make sure all of my relationships are their relationships. They're not, you know, just I'm selling you something. So really taking the time to, you know, learn their story, like I said, which I'm passionate about, so that's easy. But, you know, really actually caring about them and their business and their success, I think is important. And I would say that probably most of my, I mean, I would say all of my clients would agree that, you know, whether they're advertisers or marketing clients, that I genuinely care about their success, and they can see that. And I think when, you know, you are able to convey that and you are very genuine in your intentions, you know, I think focusing on the relationship is going to result in a sale. So you like, don't focus on the sale, focus on building the relationship and the sale will come.
Yeah. And I love what you said, you know, how much you care about their success. Going with that attitude, I think, will change everything. Because if you're going in with an attitude, I have to make a sale, it's about me, 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 this is where you lose people. But I think what you do best is you truly go in with that understanding and with that drive. How can I make your business better? How can I showcase you the best? How can I deliver you the biggest results? And that right here is the golden coin for success and truly the true sales, the true, you know, meaning of that exchange where you deliver value, you create that win-win for everybody. Absolutely. I mean, oh my God, ladies, I literally could have taken, like, if I had a notebook, I would be writing things down like mad woman right now. I mean, this is content like brilliance right here. I mean, sparkles, everything. So I'm so grateful. You have no idea. But before we let you go, I want to ask you the same question I ask of all my guests. So if you were, now that you've been in this for this long and you've had all these experiences and you're expanding in different states, if you were to give advice to a woman building a business who is young, starting out, or maybe not young, just starting out, or maybe rebranding herself, what would be your one advice to that female who is ready to start?
Well, funny enough, this is kind of what drew me to you and your mission with I Start First. And my piece of advice would be to just start. Because I definitely, you know, I think a lot of us get hung up on, we have to have everything perfect and we have to have this plan in place. And we get really stuck in like, it's got to be like, now that I have this plan, that's the direction I have to go. And, you know, that idea of still, you know, like being able to pivot and shift and, you know, change things as you need to. You know, even with me expanding my business, I mean, you know, you kind of helped give me that push, you know, to finally just do it. You know, it's kind of like you have to just start, because you're not going to have all the answers in beforehand. And things are going to, once you start doing it, you're going to find that things, you're going to learn things that you didn't know before and wouldn't have known before you started it. So just start moving and you can start putting the pieces in place as you go. Because getting started is the hardest part. So that would be my biggest piece of advice is, if you have an idea, just get started. Don't worry about like what other people are going to think. If it fails, it fails. Like, I mean, just get it started and give it a try and see what happens. And I think that, you know, that's probably the hardest part, is just getting started. And it's the most important thing.
I'm having like a moment over here, ladies. And I promise you, I did not ask her. I did not even tell her she's going to have this question. But man, I just, we just got a spokesperson for I Start First Brand. I love that. I could not state this better myself. I mean, getting started. And I mean, everything you said, I mean, amen to every word in those phrases she just said. It's so, so true. I mean, we just get hung up and we want that perfection and we're so worried about judgments and fears and doubts, but we can't outread them. We can't outwatch them. We literally have to do, it's like what Cynthia just said. You know, I love what you said when you can't go, you can predict all the things you don't know. You can't possibly know all those things until you actually start doing all those things. So ladies, I mean, you can be just as fabulous. She gave you pretty much the blueprint of everything she's doing. So the way to get there is to truly just get started and experimenting and figuring things out in the process. Cynthia, from the bottom of my heart and everybody on the I Start First tribe, I am so, so grateful. Thank you for being with us tonight. You are amazing, amazing, amazing. And ladies, we will put all the pieces in the notes so you can find her on Instagram and social media and see her fabulous website. Thank you again for being with us today.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much for listening to I Start First podcast. If you loved it as much as I did, feel free to tag us on Instagram at istartfirst_. Share it with your besties. And if you feel so compelled, give us that 5-star review on iTunes. Till next time, and like always, kick ass and sparkle up.